In 1 Corinthians 1, when we're told that God is faithful and it is He who calls us into fellowship with Jesus. It is God who calls us into our awareness, our understanding, our relationship, our fellowship, our belonging to Jesus. And for me this morning, that's really good news. Because our faithfulness just will never match the faithfulness of God. But it is God who helps us. It is God who calls us. It is God who encourages us into our relationship, into our awareness, our fellowship with Jesus. And so this morning, as you come into this space, if you, your own two feet brought you here this morning, right? You made the decision in your own heart and your mind to come in fellowship with God. But I want you to know this morning that God is pursuing fellowship with you. God is choosing you. God is encouraging your faith, increasing your expectation to bring you nearer and nearer to Jesus. And so as we worship this morning, may you be blessed to know that God is already ahead of you. Already ahead of you, preparing a place for you, pulling you forward, pulling you nearer into that relationship with Jesus. It's not all on you. And so where you might feel a little bit like one foot in, one foot out sometimes, or you might feel like, gosh, I come with a weak faith this morning, or it was hard to get here, but here I am. The good news for you this morning is that God is calling you into God's presence. God is drawing you near. God is fellowshipping with you. God is pursuing you. And so, Spirit of God, we ask now that you would give us the gift of faith to know, God, that it's not just about what we bring, but it's about who you are, calling us into relationship, nearness, connection with your Son, Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
Just receive that for a minute. Receive that God is pulling you near right now. God is drawing you in. And sometimes our most faithful response is just to say, I'm coming. I'm following your lead. Spirit of God, help me draw nearer to you. And so let's use this time just to alert ourselves to where God's presence is drawing us near. God's presence is calling us closer. Let's use this time to become alert to a God who is reconciling us in his presence right now.
That's verse 3 again. Sing it together.
Pardon for sin,
and the peace that thine own presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hopes for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000. Bless you, Jesus. We lift up to you all our lives and our hands and our hearts, Lord Jesus. Come and have your way. Fill this room, our King and our God. Thank you, Jesus. My whole life down,
before you. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down, my whole life down before you. Just lift up your hands. I lift my hands up, lay my whole life down, my whole life down before you.
Respond to his calling. Respond to his words and his voice. Lord, we take a moment, take the time. We breathe in your presence, Lord, and we respond to you, Lord, today. We worship you. Spring. breathe in the presence of God.
So
running.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrender now, I give you everything,
everything.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing in the goodness.
Some this morning that would say, I'm ready for the goodness of God to catch up with me right now. I'm ready for my heart to be fully alert to the God who is calling me into fellowship with God. Because whatever is going on in your life right now, whatever you're wrestling with, whatever you are currently experiencing, maybe it's pain in your body or pain in your heart or pain in relationships or friends, we have a lot of pain going on in the world right now, right? We woke up this morning to a lot of pain and suffering in the world right now, and if not in our own lives, if not in our own communities, we know halfway across the world, right? We need to experience the goodness of God catching up with us. We need to know that it is God who is calling us into fellowship with God. And as Isaiah declares, the foundation of God's throne are righteousness and justice.
Yes,
that the government that Jesus establishes is peace, both in our own lives and in all of the world, in all of creation. And so if you want an extra measure of the knowledge and the experience of the goodness of God that is with you and is for you this morning, just simply open up your hands right now to God. Just open up your hands to God. Come, Holy Spirit. God, see our open hands as a sign to you that we're ready to receive who you are and what you give. Establish your righteousness and justice and peace in our lives, that our lives would be a declaration to the world of your nearness and your presence, of your goodness, of your fellowship with us, God. That you are a God who is not far off, but you are a God who is nearer than our very breath. So come, Holy Spirit, and in this time, in our day, in this moment, in our lives, in our pain, in our questions, in our world, establish your peace and your goodness in us right now. That your goodness would rest heavy on the earth. That your goodness would rest heavy in our hands, heavy on our hearts, heavy on our feet, and that it would be your goodness that would order our steps and our thoughts. That you would order our spirits and you would guide our hearts in accordance with the kind of government, the kind of leadership that you give, that you establish. Keep our hearts firmly planted in your kingdom today, God. Let's take a moment together this morning to join our hearts and to pray for all those who are experiencing oppression right now in our world. We know that that's not the heart of God, and it's not the way of God, and it's not the way God establishes God's kingdom among us. And this morning I was thinking, as I was praying for our world, that when we come together, we serve as a protest to the oppression. We collectively come together and we stand for righteousness and justice and peace in the way of the kingdom. And we protest evil. We protest oppression. We say no to it. And so right now, let's declare together, Holy Spirit, draw near to the brokenhearted. Those across our world and in Israel and the Gaza Strip and in Ukraine. Those across our world right now who are suffering at the hands of oppression, of evil, of brokenness. Let your mercy fall. Let your goodness fall. Let your righteousness and your justice fall. We declare your peace, God. You are a God who makes a way when there seems to be no way. And we do not forget that you are the God who holds this all together. And it is all held in your love. So establish your kingdom. And for those of us who are here who sometimes say we don't know what to do, we welcome your kingdom first to be established in our own lives.
Yes, Jesus.
So that we can be your agents of peace and righteousness and justice. Come, Holy Spirit. God, in our worship, continue to draw us into right relationship with you. Continue to bring us under the authority of your goodness and your faithfulness this morning. so that we would declare with our bodies and our words and our hearts and our minds that you are on the throne and your faithfulness extends to 1,000 generations.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
Continue to awaken and open up our hearts now to receive from you, to learn from you, to hear your word and to know what's true. May the gospel be alive in this place and in our church this morning. Yes. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, so we declare freedom. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, we declare your freedom is in this place. Amen. Amen. This is the best place we can be right now. This is the best place that we can be to encourage one another, to be encouraged by one another, to experience the faithfulness and the goodness and the presence of Jesus. This was God's plan. It was God's design. The church isn't plan B or C or D. It's plan A in your life to bring you into fellowship and into relationship with God. And so I just want to affirm your presence here this morning. You are a gift. And you're so important here. Your presence is so essential to the body of Christ, to the church. And also, this is such a gift to you. And so I pray you receive that this morning. This is such a gift to you. This is God's design, God's way of bringing you into fellowship with Jesus, with the power and the authority of the gospel. And so if you need that release in your life this morning, and I do, I need it released in my life. I need it released in my family and my relationships. I need the gospel released in my heart right now. If you're anything like me, you're in the best place you could possibly be, because that's our mission this morning, is to declare the freedom and the gospel of Jesus Christ to one another. Amen. So I'm glad you are here. Whatever it took for you to get here, I'm glad you are here. And I pray that the Spirit of God is enlivening your faith, increasing your faith, even now as you sit in this place and receive. Sometimes we're giving, sometimes we're receiving. And may you receive right now the goodness and the faithfulness of God. Amen.
Yeah. Well, we're going to dive in today. No messing around. We're going to jump right in. I realize our time is short, and I've got somewhere about an hour and a half of content, and so I'm going to try to cram this into about 25 minutes or so, and at some point, we'll just stop. But if it's going well, maybe we'll just keep going. But if I notice that malaise coming over the crowd, you know, just a general malaise and angst, then we'll just stop, and we'll pick up again next week. So it's kind of what we do here. We tend to do this every Sunday, and so I figure we'll be back again next week. But I'm going to start in Psalm 16. Our series is on the screen if you're new or just joining us. We're talking about the real life. We're talking about an invitation to become fully human. If that seems kind of nebulous or out there, and we'll hopefully put some flesh on them bones, as we have been doing over the course of the last few weeks. But Psalm 16 is where we're going to start today. I just want to read the whole thing straight through. It's 11 verses. It's attributed to David. And so we're going to read this psalm and just kind of sit with it today and let it sit with us and work on it. All summer, we were in our Songs of Summer. We're kind of back there again. I know it's fall, but we're back into the Psalms back there again. So Psalm 16, the psalmist writes this: "Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, these are the noble ones in whom is all my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad. My tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. People of God, this is the word of the Lord to us this morning. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. You see, this is what God does. This is just what God does, and this is what God promises to do. For you and I this morning, this is what's on offer. This is what this is all about. Because the truth is, every one of us is on some kind of path today, aren't we? Every human being is on a path, and there are all different kinds of paths, and we can label those paths in all different kinds of ways, but all of us are on a path. But the psalmist says here that as we experience life with God, abundant, real, authentic life with God, what we end up finding is the path of what? It's the path of life. He says that's what we experience. What we experience is the path of life. You see, this is what God does. And what God will do, the promise here, what God promises to do is that as we press into that abundant life, that real life, that authentic life, that as we walk, as you could say it this way, as we walk that path of life, what you'll notice the promise there after that is that God will, we have found life. It says, you will fill us with exceeding amounts of what? Joy. Is that your story this morning? Is that what you have found to be true this morning? Because for so many of us in this room today, I know a bit of your story. I've walked with so many of you for many years, and I know some of your story, and I know that for so many of us, this is what we have found to be true. This is what we have found to be real. This is that we have found this path of life through Jesus. We have literally found life, and in doing so, the promise is when we find the path of life, when we find life in Jesus, we find what? We find joy. So many people hungering, thirsting, wondering, wanting joy. And the psalmist says, the promise is we walk the path of life. We find life with God. We find their joy. Is that your story this morning? And if that's not your story, and that's okay if it's not, or if it's not your story right now on this part of your journey, then may this be God's invitation to you this morning. May the invitation to you today, this morning, it's an invitation to start walking that path of life, to start believing that as I walk the path of life with Jesus, there can actually be real, authentic joy in my life. Maybe for you today, it's an invitation to return. You're like, at one time, I was walking that path of life. I remember that kind of transcendent joy. I remember something that just seemed more. It wasn't fleeting. It was kind of eternal in some ways. So maybe it's just a call back to that today. Maybe the invitation's a call back to that path because you realize, yeah, a thief and a robber, somebody took the joy. Something took the joy. And so no matter where you find yourself this morning, can we take a moment, can we pray, and can we ask the Holy Spirit this morning for a fresh impartation of life? And because I know that in doing so, when we find life, we find what? Joy. And so let's just press into that. So Lord, would you release life and joy in this place this morning? Would you set us and keep us on the path of life? We thank you for your promise of joy. And so as we do this together, as we do this in community, as we press into your word, we want to hear from you this morning. Would you keep our eyes on you always? Keep our attention on you always. We need you this morning. We need your life, and we need your joy. We pray and ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, we're going to come back here to Psalm 16 in just a few minutes or so, or in an hour and 20 minutes or so. I don't know. We will come back. I keep saying that, and some of you are getting really nervous. You're like, is he serious? He may be. He may be. But we'll try to get back here because I want to come back to Psalm 16 in a few minutes because I think it has something else to say to us. That was verse 11, but I think there's some other things in there that are going to speak some, hopefully, a fresh word to us today. But I want to take us back to last week. And I know some of you weren't here last week, so I'll do a crash course of where we were last week in this series. Because last week, I want to go back to what we ended with. And we ended with a quote from a guy by the name, who's no longer with us. He was a Catholic monk and wrote mostly in the 1940s and 50s, Thomas Merton. And we ended with this line from Thomas Merton, what he referred to as a protest and a reparation against the sin of noise. Now, I know taken completely out of context and just putting it up there, if you weren't here last week, you're like, what on earth does that mean? We ended with talking about a protest, yes. We were talking about being protesters last week. We were talking about this idea of what if the church is called to protest, a protest and a reparation against the sin of noise. Because, yeah, I believe that this path of life, which we are each called on, it may involve the good old-fashioned protest. In fact, I believe it will. This is not a protest with signs, and this is not a protest with bullhorns, and this is not a protest with lots and lots of yelling, because this is a protest against the sin of noise. Over the past few weeks, we have been talking about what I would term incredible challenge of pursuing an authentic, real, vibrant, full spiritual life in a world that you and I live in where there is so much noise and so many distractions. Whether it's the literal noise, for some of us it is the literal noise and the many distractions that come at us, just life in our home, right? The noise of the home, the literal noise in your home, or the noise at work, or the distractions at work, or the distractions that are continuously coming to you at school, or wherever it might be, wherever you might find yourselves. For some of us, it's just everyday life. Wherever you find yourself, there's a lot of noise, and there are a lot of distractions. I would call this life in LA County. For others of us, maybe it's the noise, this noise that we're talking about, or these distractions that we're talking about. Do I need that? Do I keep cutting out? Let's do this. Let's just do this. All right, come on. Pay no attention to the worship guy behind me. Who's going to change the battery? I can just go like this. I don't need to do Britney Spears, but I can. But if you got better batteries, I'll plug back in. All right. Takes a few seconds for him to. Now he's getting nervous and his hands are sweating because he's doing this publicly. Are we going to plug that in? Okay. There we go. Are we better? Let's try that. All right. I'll keep this just in case. I'll keep it close. What were we talking about? Noise. Distractions. The distraction of a microphone battery pack that keeps cutting out. Maybe it's that. You're like, I haven't been able to pay attention to a thing you've said all day because you keep cutting out. For some of us, it's this internal noise, isn't it? It's not actually audible noise. It's all internal. It's the noise of their voice that keeps coming back to us. You know what I mean by that? It's the voice. It's for some of us, they're not even alive anymore. But their voice is still there. And that distraction is still there. And we're reliving those moments. And it's creating noise. And it's creating distraction. And it prevents us from a vibrant spiritual life. Or maybe, and this is where we've been kind of pressing in and doing some really introspection, maybe it's the noise of being tethered to what I'm calling today a digital appendage that's always notifying us that someone or something needs your attention rather than what's right in front of you, right? This digital appendage that's all, it's there. It's like it's living with us. Something, someone just shared something. Someone just posted something. You're missing out on something. Or that's just there, and I'll say it this way, that digital appendage that's there to make quite certain you and I have no uninterrupted moments in our life any longer. That we never have those uninterrupted moments. That you and I are never, dare I say, alone, right? We're always on. We're always connected. We're never alone. Dare I say we're never bored? Oh, to think that you and I would ever be bored today, right? No, you and I have a digital appendage that makes sure we're never bored. A recent survey done by Microsoft found that 77% of people said that when nothing is occupying their attention, their very first impulse is to reach for their phone. 77% of human beings admitted, when there is not something occupying my attention, my first impulse is to distract myself with my phone. Think of what you see or think of what you experience. Let's say, have you ever been in an airport terminal? What do you picture everybody doing in an airport terminal? Having kind, friendly conversation with the people around them, right? That's the picture you get. Just reading their Bibles or reading the latest novel or doing... No. The picture you have of an airport terminal is everybody doing what? Staring down at something in their laps or in line at the grocery store. You can be productive now in line at the grocery store. Some of us do email while standing in line at the grocery store. We are always on, always productive, always digitally tethered in a waiting room. I had a doctor's appointment 2 weeks ago, and I went and I just sat in the waiting room. It was dead silent. There was no music on. It was the oddest thing. It was just dead silent. Usually they have that ambient music on to kind of take away. And I just sat there, and I thought, I'm going to protest. And I just sat there and stared at people and looked around the room. As everybody was staring down, I literally sat there until they called my name, just looking at people, saying, Lord, what is it? What is it? Everyone's staring down. Everyone's disconnected, and they think they're connected. At a stoplight, some of us, we can't even get through a stoplight. It's our first impulse. I've got 30 seconds at a stoplight. I can check something, right? I can see something. In a cafeteria at high school. I don't know what the high school cafeterias are like today, or junior high cafeterias, if they allow those. I'm assuming it's not a ton of chatter and such. It's relatively quieter now. In a meeting, in a professional development teacher's meeting, when you're slightly bored or, you know, I'm not in this anymore, I just can check out. Or in a sermon, you're like, ah, okay, this is not that interesting. I'll just, distract myself with something else. This is actually led, and this is actually real. I checked this week. You know, this has actually led to a very real condition or syndrome that doctors are now calling phantom vibration syndrome. Have you heard of this? Some of you know what this is, and I haven't even described it yet. You know exactly what I'm talking about because you have experienced phantom vibration syndrome. And for some of you, you're like, I have no idea what that is. I'll probably diagnose you in the next 30 seconds. Phantom vibration syndrome is clinically defined and described now as that sense you get that your phone is trying to notify you of something when it's actually not. I don't want to see a show of hands, but just looking at some of you, you're like, I got it. I have PVS. I am constantly thinking I'm being notified. There is a reason why you have that. There is a reason. I'm trying to decide what I do for the sake of time. Let me show you a short video. This is coming from research out of Georgia Tech University. Here's their definition of phantom vibration syndrome and why you and I have this. We'll need the audio in the back. What is phantom vibration syndrome?
Your phone vibrating in your pocket as if you're receiving a call or text, but you pull your phone out and you look at it and it never actually rang. Studies are finding that while most don't find this to be very bothersome, a lot of people are experiencing this. A recent study of undergraduates found that almost 90% are experiencing this hallucination. So the question is, why? Why is this happening to us? Some claim that technologies like the phone are somehow rewiring our brains, but I think that a better way to understand the phone and other technologies is in terms of learned bodily habits. Think about wearing a pair of glasses. If you're accustomed to your glasses and they almost become a part of you, you can forget that you're even wearing them sometimes. Phone in your pocket is like this. through bodily habit, the phone actually becomes a part of you, and you become trained to perceive the phone's vibrations as an incoming call or text. So due to these kinds of habits, it becomes really easy to misperceive other similar sensations. Phone shifts around in your pocket, I'm getting a call. Your pant leg rustles, I'm getting a text. You have a muscle spasm in your leg, I'm getting another call again, but the whole time, just a phantom vibration.
All right. I don't know if you heard what he said. He said, through bodily habit, your phone actually becomes a part of you. Remember I called it is a digital appendage. It literally, they're saying, the research is showing, it is literally becoming a part of you. Can you imagine trying to explain phantom vibration syndrome to someone in 1955? Just imagine trying to explain that. Like, yeah, it's this kind of weird thing I get that my phone is trying to get a hold of me. They'd be like, you mean that thing, that rotary thing that is like attached to the wall is trying to get it? Like, yeah. In 60, 70, 80 years, that is going to be a part of it. I mean, just imagine trying to explain those things. Yes, John? Right. Still feel it. It's the same kind of phenomenon. I heard someone else call this they called it the digital carnivore. I think that's a good expression of it. And they called it a digital carnivore because they said it was bent on swallowing up the last remaining bits of our time and our attention. That's what it ends up doing. It devours. It's noise and it's distraction, sure, but what it ends up devouring or consuming is our time and our attention. And so just for a few minutes, that's what I want to talk to us about today. I want to talk to us this idea. I want to talk to us about our time. I want to talk to us about our attention and the reason why we're keeping this in front of our church community, the reason why we just continue to talk about this and why I see this, there's a reason why we see this as just so vital when it comes to our own spiritual formation and the abundant life that Jesus calls us to. And I think there's some really key reasons, or some really vital reasons. And I think one of them is that those last remaining bits of our time and our attention, there was a time when those uninterrupted moments, they were portals for us to engage God in everyday life. They were opportunities, portals, when we could engage God or the goodness of God. We sang about that today, about the goodness of God, the beauty of God. There was a time when we had a lot more of that than we do now. All those quiet moments when we used to come alive to God and to the goodness of God and the beauty of God in the world, to engage all those moments that we used to have to engage in real life with real people that were right in front of us. All of that is becoming increasingly more difficult. It's interesting because I actually was formulating a lot of these thoughts while I was sitting here on Friday afternoon. I was on the back porch of an Airbnb overlooking the hills around Tehachapi. If you know where Tehachapi, California is, we were at a vineyard conference, and I took the afternoon off on Friday just to sit at our Airbnb on the porch. And we were completely, actually this Airbnb was advertised as being off the grid, and it really was. It was way out there, off the grid. And the first thing that we recognized, it was so what? Quiet. Oh my gosh, I forgot how quiet it can be. It was just dead quiet. And so I was formulating a lot of these thoughts, and what a gift it was to sit out here in this absolutely kind of barren landscape, and it was quiet, and to turn off my digital appendage or to silence it. Ironically, yes, I know, after I took this photo. But after I took this photo, to then put it on, literally to put it on Do Not Disturb for 2 straight hours, and to have just this quiet and this time to soak in the goodness and the beauty of God, to sit in this uninterrupted stillness. Nothing was notifying me. Nothing had my attention, only God. The Eremos, as Abigail talked about a few weeks ago, and to literally found my own soul coming alive to the goodness and the beauty of God in new and profound ways. I think the inability to be attentive for longer periods of time, I think it's another threat. I think it's another blind spot. I know it is for me. I think it's a thief, and I think it's a robber. And it ultimately, what it ultimately does is it robs us of the capacity to be fully present to God, to be fully alive to God and to others, to our families, to each other, and to our own soul. It's robbing us and preventing of us of that capacity. It takes us off, if we want to go back to Psalm 16, it takes us off the path of life. It ends up stealing or robbing those moments of joy, enjoying all the inherent goodness of relationships and people and nature and beauty. Just to sit in that stillness, it robs us of that. Interestingly enough, after talking about some of these things and last Sunday and preaching about some of this, I took our eldest daughter, who's in the room, Grace. Grace and I went to a concert last Sunday night, and I know Karen and Liliana were there on Saturday night, but we were at the Rose Bowl, and there were like seven, it was sold out, Coldplay. Any Coldplay fans? We were there for Coldplay. 70,000, two nights last Saturday night and Sunday night, two nights they sell out 70,000 people, so 140,000, you know, sold out there. And so we're sitting here at this Coldplay concert, and these were our seats, and if you know anything about Coldplay, I mean, their shows are just, I don't know how to adequately describe their shows other than sensory overload. I mean, that's really what it is. It's just sensory overload. It's really hard to describe, but it's 70,000 people and all this. But there was a moment in the show when they were playing like one of the big songs, you know, and it's fireworks and lights and everything. And all of a sudden, lead singer of Coldplay, Chris Martin, just stops the show. He just stops. And the band stops, and it all goes dark. And he just says, I just want to thank you. He's like, I just thank you so much for coming out tonight. And he starts talking about how thankful he is for all these people that are here. 70,000 of us, he goes, fill this beautiful place. The Rose Bowl, here we are, 70,000 of us. He's like, thank you so much. Thank you. And he goes, but I just have one request. He goes, I just want to have one request for this next song. Because you all know the song. You've seen it on YouTube. We all know the song. And we're going to sing it. It's going to be amazing. He goes, can I just ask you to do one thing for this one moment? He goes, because we are never going to, he says these words. He says, we are never going to have this moment in time again. He's like, we will never get together, all 70,000 of us, like this. We're never going to have this moment again. This is it. This is it. We're going to have this moment together. And he goes, for one song, would you put your phone away? And would you put your hands, he goes, I want phones in pockets and hands to the sky. And he said, and we're just going to sing, and there's going to be an explosion in this place. And there was this kind of like, because you know what everyone's doing at a concert, you've ever been to one. I mean, everyone's watching the thing, live streaming the thing on Instagram, everyone's filming it like this. He goes, come on, everyone, please. And he literally, he like pauses and he won't go on. He says, we're going to have a human moment here together. And so then he just starts singing, put your phone in your pocket and your hands to the sky. But then around the place, all of a sudden, people start doing this. Like every phone goes away. Grace said, except the guy next to her who wouldn't stop streaming the thing. He's like this, you know, he's like hiding it. And I kid you not, they play this song. There was a life and a joy there. This something was like exploded with 70,000 people. Now, I'm still trying to theologically understand what happened in that moment. I'm just trying to process, like, what was going on in that moment. But what was the lead singer of Coldplay talking about? Giving our what? Time and attention. It's like, we're going to have this moment of time, and we're going to give our full attention just to this experience we're going to have together. And I'm thinking, this is coming from him. And there was this different kind of joy and a different kind of life. And for some reason, to me, it sounded a whole lot like Psalm 16. And so we've invited you to kind of join us in this bit of protest. And I know it's countercultural living. It's utterly unique. We're trying to reclaim some of our humanity together. And last week, it took this real-life invitation. The forum was just to kind of like, let's distance ourselves from our from our digital appendages. You know, when we come together in community, when we're with our families, when we're out doing community types of spaces, what would it look like to limit or to distance ourselves so that we can create this kind of holy place? And maybe some of you tried that this week. I'd love to hear from you. We don't really have time today. I just want to show you real quick what happened in this room on Wednesday night. You know, we're doing Alpha with our youth on Wednesday night. And we talked about kind of similar stuff. And before Alpha started, actually Leonard started it, one of our volunteers. He just went up and he put his phone. We're going to start Alpha. We're going to press. And he just went up and he put his phone on the stage. And there was this kind of like awkward moment of all the teenagers like looking at each other. And we were talking about this, like, because they're, you know, doing their thing on their phone. We're going to start Alpha. We're going to like try to hear what God wants us to say. And then a couple of our seniors were next, and Grace and Liliana walked up and put their phone on the stage. And then, I don't know if you can see it, it's not good with our thing because it's kind of dark. It's an Apple Watch on the stage. One by one, they just start putting down their devices on the stage and just left them there. And I'll tell you, there was something different. Just something different about the room. There was like a new kind of focus and a togetherness. And it was just this beautiful moment. You know, it was also Thomas Merton who encouraged us. He said, those who love God should attempt to preserve or create an atmosphere in which he can be found, in which God can be encountered. Because when we find or we encounter the presence of God, what we find or encounter is the path of life, and we find lasting joy. Now, real quick, if we go back to Psalm 16, I think Psalm 16, very briefly here, has something to say when it comes to time and attention. What do we give our time to? What do we give our attention to? The psalmist, which we said this psalm, which is attributed to David, he says there is something that he will not do, and then there is something that he will do instead. And it's that decision to say no to something and then to say yes to something far better. It's that decision that literally puts him on the path of life. Because it's going to require a decision. We have to make a decision. That decision puts him on the path of life and releases that joy that we all want and we all long for. So let's talk about those two things. First, what he will not do. In verse 4, if we go back to verse 4, Psalm 16, verse 4, this is what he says he will not do. In verse 4, he's talking about those who run after other gods. He's like, yeah, there are those. And they run after other gods. Now, the reality when David is writing this about these other gods, this is likely a reference to the very real practice of idolatry, right? I mean, this was pagan sacrifice. He's talking about this idea that there are other local deities, local forces, local gods, and there are people of faith that are making sacrifice and devotion and are devoted to these other gods. And here he says, he observes that those who do that, who live this way, he says, they end up suffering more and more. And then he says what he will not do, and I'll put it in bold here. He says, I will not pour out libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. In other words, David is saying, when it comes to those gods, I'm not giving them my what? Time or my attention. Those gods, those idols, they're not going to have my time. Not going to do it. Not going to have my attention. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb in the room and assume that most of us in this room have never offered an animal sacrifice. Yeah? I'm waiting for that one hand to be like, actually, in high school, I got in this bad crowd, and we were up in the hills of Glendale. Stuff went on, right? Most of us have never offered blood sacrifice to pagan gods, yeah? Right. I'd be a rookie too if I'm with you there. It seems to me that doing that is kind of a large act of devotion. Wouldn't you agree? Like, it takes a bit of work to offer a blood sacrifice. That's a lot. I don't know. I'm going to guess to offer an animal sacrifice takes a lot of time and a lot of attention. And probably some money too, right? You're giving up one of your animal. You're like sacrificing something. There's a sacrifice. It takes money. It takes time. It takes attention. You got to get the animal. You got to get the animal to the pagan altar. You got to actually go through the thing and sharpen the knife and actually do the thing and pour out the blood. I mean, it's horrible, right? The amount of time it must take to offer blood sacrifices. The amount of attention you got to pay to that animal is you're like, did I sever the neck? I don't know. What vein do I have to hit to get the right amount of, am I going too far here, right? All right, some of you are like, all right, please, we're going to lunch in a few minutes, we think. I'll stop there. I had more, but I'll stop there. And so what David does is he offers a bit of a what? Protest, doesn't he? He says, I'm not doing that. I know there are others who do. Not me. I'm not spending my time that way. I'm not giving that my attention. I've seen what it costs people. He says, I see the fear and the insecurity of those who offer blood sacrifice to these pagan gods, and they never know if they quite measure up. They're always living with FOMO. They're always living with this fear of missing out on something. I didn't offer the right sacrifice. I see the fear it brings. I see the insecurity it brings. I see the suffering as the God promises what it can never deliver. It always promises all these things, but it can never deliver these things. I see the disappointment and I see the disconnection. It's so disconnected from what is real and what is true and what is authentic and what is lasting, he says. I see that. He says, that's why he says, they just suffer more and more. Those who run after those gods, they suffer more and more. It offers a kind of life, but it's not the path of life. It's a cheap imitation. It takes away from the authentic, real thing. And now, again, I assume that sacrificing animals and spending lots of time and attention pouring out blood to pagan gods, I assume that's not our primary struggle, right? But think about that protest when it comes to the gods of our day. Think about when it comes to the idols that, like Abigail talked about 2 weeks ago, of constant connection and distraction that do the same thing. What do they create? Fear and insecurity, and I'm missing out. They just do, it's the same exact thing, the fear, or the idols of busyness and productivity that keep me thinking I've got to keep going and going and going. And what do they end up leaving me? Chronically fatigued and anxious. I'm just chronically fatigued and anxious. I just can never catch up. What would it look like for us to say, I'm not giving those gods my time and attention? Like that. They're not going to get it. I got to say no to some things. So then what will he do? What will he do? Because it said, you say no to something, right? Then you got to say yes to something else. What does David say he will do? Verse 7 and 8. Instead, I'll use my lips to praise the Lord, who counsels me. And then he says, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will never be shaken. David says, that's how I'll spend my time. That's what I'll do with my lips. That's what I'm going to do. And he says he will literally, look at that, verse 8, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. Now, I know he's speaking figuratively, but when you keep your eyes on someone, it means you're giving that person your full what? Attention. I'll keep my eyes, my full attention on the Lord. Time and attention are so vital when it comes to our spiritual life and development. I would go as far to say they are the portal through which we experience and learn to love God and to be loved by God. That's it. Can I go 5 more minutes? Can I go 5 more? I know, I'm aware of time. Can I go 5 more minutes? And it'll probably be 7. But I got to land this somewhere for because Pastor Karen's speaking next week. I'm going to take this the next step. I got to get her to the next step. 5 more minutes? Kids are okay. All right. Thank you. You're very gracious. Time and attention are the portals through which we learn, and we learn to love God and be loved by God. If you think about it, time and attention, they are the ways. Are time and attention not the ways that we experience love? It's just how it is. It's how we experience. It's how we express love. Think about how loved you feel when somebody in your life gives you their unhurried what? Time and their undivided what? Attention. You feel loved, right? When you're in a conversation and they are just eye contact with you. They're not constantly going, wait, hold on, wait, yeah, yeah. There's like, okay, I feel loved. They gave me their, and it's not hurried. It's like, I got all day. What do you want to talk about? Unhurried time and attention. It's how we experience love. And think about the opportunities we then have to show not only in our relationship with God, but also to show someone else love by doing the same. Because when we are fully present, we have this amazing opportunity to experience all the life and the joy that God offers us, and then in turn we can offer that to others. Now, think about what that digital carnivore or that digital appendage devours. It devours all of our uninterrupted or remaining what? Time and attention, every last bit of it. Last week I read from this article, it's an article by Andrew Sullivan. If you haven't found this one yet, you need to read this one. I used to be a human being, it was in the New Yorker in 2016. I quoted extensively from it last week. This is written from a non-faith perspective, it's not coming from, but saying some poignant prophetic things. And in this, he has this one line that I didn't quote last week. I'll just read this. He says, "You are where your attention is." If you're watching a football game with your son, also texting a friend, you're not fully with your child, and he knows it. Truly being with another person means being experientially with them, picking up countless tiny signals from the eyes. That's that eye contact thing, right? The voice, body language, context, reacting, often unconsciously, to every nuance. These are our deepest social skills, which have been honed through the eons. They, and this is, look at this, they are what make us distinctly what? Human. This is what makes us human. And like I said, I'm sure most of us have experienced this, we've observed this, that you are where your attention is. This is why sociologist Sherry Turkle, in her book, coined this phrase, we have this ability today to be alone together. We can be together, and we can also be very, very lonely together. You know, people like to say certain things about time. Maybe you've heard someone say, you know, where time, it just what? Just flies by. Especially when talking about kids and raising kids, right? People say things like, where did the time go? Like time went somewhere. Or they say things like, yeah, you know, raising kid, time, you know, time flies by. To which I heard someone recently respond to that, yeah, maybe, but not if you're there. I just sat on that for a while. What were they saying? Yeah, time flies by and time goes by and it can seem, but if you're there, if your attention is with them and you're there, maybe it doesn't. If you're there and if you're attentive, then maybe it actually works in reverse. Maybe it actually redeems the time. Maybe it doesn't go anywhere. Maybe time doesn't actually fly anywhere by. Maybe time can be savored like a wonderful meal if we would just slow down and be present, chew, and not just swallow. If you're there, giving your full attention, fully present, phone in your pocket and your hands to the sky, as Coldplay taught us, 70,000 of us, to be. If you're there in real time, giving your full attention, then you're not missing out on life or letting it go by. You're what? You're living it. You're experiencing it. You're living it to the full. And like David said, then you're actually on the path of life, where I promise you there is joy to be had. And you know what is true of our human relationships? It's true in our relationship with God. If we're going to live this life that is truly life, it's going to mean saying no to certain things. I got to say no to certain of the idols in my life in order to say yes to other things. It will mean saying yes to giving God my full attention. As the psalmist said, to keep my eyes always on the Lord. And so what might that look like? That might, for some of us, just looks like, so I give you my time, I give you the first bit of my time and my attention every day, Lord. The first part of my time, the first part, the first day of every week, I come here, I give a bit of my time and my attention. It may mean, yeah, like some of us are doing, taking a digital Sabbath, literally cutting off the appendage for 24 hours of time and saying, you know what, I'm going to be fully present to God and to others. And like I said, next week Pastor Karen's going to take this a step further. There's a wonderful practice from the life of Jesus as it pertains to redeeming time and attention, and we're going to really hone in on that this week. But for this week, we've been doing this every week. I want to end with a real-life invitation. And by the way, everything we're talking about here, there is absolutely no guilt and no shame. We did not shame any children for not throwing their iPhones up or their phones up on the stage. What actually began to happen is it was like positive peer pressure. It was almost like for the ones that were like clutching it, like, no. All of a sudden it was like, maybe. Okay. And then, so no guilt, no shame. This is like all, following Jesus has always been invitational. But this is an invitation. And here's the invitation for this week. To give God your time and attention in those moments when you're tempted to be distracted or productive and you don't need to be. So in those moments, and they will happen, where you're like, this is when I would normally, this is that 77% of the time, right? I would normally reach for something because I'm feeling bored or distracted. I would reach for something to numb. I need a dopamine hit, whatever it is. That's what it is, neurobiologically. I'm gonna stop. I'm gonna say no. Not gonna have my time and attention, and I'm gonna say yes. And you're like, well, what do I do? Could I give you a breath prayer? Help me, Lord, keep my eyes always on you. Just try that. Help me, Lord. My hands are feeling, I gotta distract. Help me, Lord, keep my eyes always on you. And just try that for this week. See how it goes. See if you're not more present to God and to others in our world. And so that's what it's going to be for this week. Can we pray that together? Abigail, you have something? You have something? No. You had the mic in your Bible like you were ready to go with something? Oh, you put your Bible down. All right. I kind of look over there and get my cues of like, yeah, I got something. Thank you for your time and your attention as we talk about time and attention. I believe the Lord's doing something, not just in us. It's interesting, as we have these conversations and as we're at Vineyard conferences, you know, big things, and we're doing stuff and we're at Coldplay concerts, it's like, this is the kind of stuff people are talking about. These are the concerns people are having. They're like, what are we doing here? Who are we becoming here? And it goes far beyond. Last anecdotal story. I show up at a school assembly at our school last Monday morning. After the Coldplay concert goes to like midnight, I show up Monday morning, like a few hours later, and this guy from Florida gets up to address all of our junior hires. He's quoting everything I quoted on Sunday, much of what I was quoting, to our junior high kids sitting there. This is what he's talking about to them. He's actually quoting Sean Parker from Facebook in an article, as it goes another direction, that I had read that week, and I'm like, oh my gosh. And so he's from like southwestern Florida. So afterwards, he and I are sitting there talking in the back, just two dads with four kids, and we're talking about these kind of things, and I shared with him what we're talking about here. He's like, man, it's interesting, isn't it? Like, God's doing something, calling his people back to attention and away from some things. So Lord, we ask that you do this in us. Give us the power that we need to be fully present to you this week. Let's just pray this together. Instead of help me, Lord, let's do help us. We'll make this communal. Can we just pray that together? Help us. Help us, Lord, keep our eyes always on you. Let's pray that again. Help us, Lord, keep our eyes always on you. Help us, Lord, keep our eyes always on you. We love you. Let's stand together and we'll sing.
So keep our eyes on the Lord. May your voice be louder. Thank you. And all the others in my